proud to have our students here in the audience as well as chairperson and like very. So I really feel proud for working in a medical institute which has got laurel to at so many places. My today's topic is case-based ovulation induction. So although this is, I think this is the whole essence of IVF practice, but or infertility practice, but I will try to cover it in the 15 minutes as much as possible.
So ovulation induction, as we all know, is the iatrogenic stimulation of ovaries for ovulation, for the development of ovarian follicle to either reverse the anovulation or an oligoovulation. So just brushing up your knowledge of the axis, why this how the agents are used for causing the ovulation induction, there may be three level of the functioning. One is hypothalamus, another is pituitary, and third is the end organs or ovaries. So all three levels should be working properly in synchrony for producing the good quality of oocytes. So the agents which are used for ovarian stimulation, they may act either at this level or pituitary level or ovarian level. So agents which we are available with us are clomiphene citrate, which is orally used. This is a selective estrogen receptor modulator. Letrozole, which is aromatase inhibitor. Amoxicillin, again selective estrogen receptor modulator. Then comes the urinary gonadotropins, halicronified gonadotropins, and most recent is recombinant gonadotropins. When we see the clomiphene and letrozole, one special thing I would like to, I think most of us are knowing only, but for discussing the cases further, I would like to specify that clomiphene act as a receptor blocker for in a general way, or you can say in all the organs of the body the receptors are blocked for estrogen. So what happens, once it is blocked the estrogen at the ovarian level, pituitary senses that there is a estrogen deficiency and they start producing FSH. So FSH, they start secreting. This FSH is keep on increasing. This stimulate more and more and more number of follicles to grow, and these number of follicles are growing and they are secreting further estrogen. But this increased estrogen is not sensed by the pituitary because of receptor blocking now. So what happens? There may be multiple follicular recruitment and unopposed estrogen in the body, which is present, but this is not sensed by the pituitary, not sensed by the endometrium. Endometrium is also not sensing this estrogen, so it becomes less receptive, and pituitary will keep on secreting FSH, so there will be multifollicular development. So oral ovulation, let's say, clomiphene, that will cause the higher chances of multiple pregnancy. When we see the letrozole, this also inhibits the estrogen secretion, but at the ovarian level, at the aromatase enzyme level, so ovaries are secreting less estrogen, pituitary senses it, produces FSH. In response to that FSH, ovarian follicular recruitment is there. These follicles, they increase secretion of the, they cause increase of secretion of estrogen further. But this further increase of secretion is sensed by the pituitary, so there is further stoppage of the growth of again the more follicle to grow. So it will cause, it will helpful in development of the monofollicular growth of the cohort. So this is the main difference why nowadays letrozole is preferred. Another is that amoxicillin, although this is used basically for the prevention or follow up for chemotherapy for the breast cancer, but in a clomiphene resistance cases it is useful in the dose of 20 to 40 milligrams per day. Most of the time these drugs are used for 5 days, either starting from day 2 of the cycle or further 5 days or day 3 of the cycle. But nowadays recent protocol has come up where they are used in a novel protocol of continuous 10 days stimulation with the oral ovulation as well. Urinary gonadotropins are least pure, HP are the little more pure, and recombinant are the, they are synthesized genetically with alpha and beta chain properly, which is required for the ovulation or oocyte growth properly. So these are considered best. Although the clinical study, all the Cochrane data and all the analysis, they are saying the potency or outcome with all these three types of gonadotropin are similar. So coming to the cases, so our first case is 28-year-old woman living with the husband and trying for conception since last 4 years. And menstrual history and pelvic examination was within normal limit. Day 2 FSH, LH, E2, AFC along with TSH, prolactin, AMH are all within normal limit. Husband, GST done 1 year back showing normal uterine cavity and bilateral patency. She was tried for spontaneous ovulation with timed intercourse 3 times, and after that she was given lactrose 2.5 mg folliculometry SCG trigger and timed intercourse for 4 more times. And now she is coming for further opinion. So what we need to do here, this is like she is already proved case, she is having ovulation. Previously proved, but what we can do further is we have to stimulate ovulation here. So this is a type of ovulation induction in ovulatory women. So ovulatory women may also require ovulation induction. It is not necessary anovulatory or oligovulatory only require. So how this ovulation induction in ovulatory women will help? So main objective of this was, this is to confirm the follicular growth at least 1 to 3. When we give the ovulation induction drugs, at least we are confirmed, we are sure that this, in this cycle at least 1 to 3 follicles may develop. And this will be, there will be the better timing of the follicular growth. Some people have late cycles and all, so there may be follicular growth may be delayed. So this growth you may time. And third thing is improved luteal phase will be there. So now what we will do further, because with the history of this, it is obvious that she is a case of unexplained infertility with evidence of ovulation present in previous cycles. What we will try this time, and all the cycles we have given with the lactrose, so we will change the ovulogen agent, we will switch over her to Nomifen citrate, HMG, SCG and IUI cycle. IUI here added along with ovular stimulation, and what is the aim of this? To have at least 2 to 3 follicles of 17 to 20 mm. Endometrium should also be properly grown to 7 to 10 mm at the time of our SCG trigger. And IUI should be planned between 13th day to 16th day and 36 to 40 hours after SCG injection of either 5000 or 10,000 international unit. So there will be better prediction of scheduling for IUI by this type of induction or stimulation, better for fertilization and implantation, and this will correct IUI. Sometimes it corrects so many anatomical and mechanical factors which are not obvious by either history or clinical examination, and when we put the IUI cannula we find that either the uterus is populated, uterus or some mechanical problems or some cervical problems may also be there. So this IUI also corrects the cervical mucus fertility, unrecognized vaginismus or dyspareunia if it is there. It also helpful in wide endometriosis because she is an unexplained infertility case. We add on all these things, and allergy to semen and plasma is also there to some women, and there is a 8-10% higher chance than the time intercourse by doing the IUI with ovarian induction in unexplained infertility of this short duration or young patients. So for these young patients, you cannot directly ask them to go for IVF or anything. So this is better to go step by step in this. So stimulation protocols for IUI, when we do only natural cycle with IUI, this is only 3% roughly. With CC it is 9.5, with addition of HMD it makes 13%, and only gonadotropin with IUI, it makes a vast difference in the IUI success, and it's roughly 17-20%. Now the case number 2. This is 31-year-old lady, pregnant since 7 years, history of oligohypomenorrhea since menarche. Her BMI is high and diagnosed as a PCOS already, and underwent diagnostic hysterolaparoscopy and also done the drilling for at that time. But bilateral tubal spillage was seen and the cavity is normal, husband parameter is also normal. She was she tried 2 cycles of again lactrose and ovulation study, and for ovulation she got the trigger of SCG with timed intercourse. So with this all this she is presented with us. Now this is a type of anovulatory infertility because already a diagnosed case of PCOS. This anovulation by WHO is categorized into 3 broad groups. One is group 1, where this is known as hypothalamic pituitary failure. This is hypogonadotropin, hypogonadism, where the pituitary is also at fault and ovary is also at fault. So both the things are at fault. So what you will find, gonadotropins are also lesser in serum and the ovulation is also not happening. Second type is eugonadotropic hypogonadism, where the FSH LH are normal but estrogen and progesterone secreted by ovary is not sufficient enough. And third is the hyperhypo, where the only ovary is at fault, So ovarian insufficiency is there, ovary is not responding to the gonadotropins. So for that response, because ovary is not responding, pituitary is start secreting more and more around of the FSH LH. So what you will find here, FSH LH will be very high, but ovary is not ovulating properly. So this is hyperthyroidism. So hyper FSH and LH, high values, and ovary will be not responsive, so ovarian failure will be there. So this is just what I said, it's the diagrammatic presentation of this. It's the normal one, pituitary is secreting normal FSH, ovary is also responsive, and normal ovulatory function is there. This is primary failure where ovary is at fault, but the pituitary is secreting to compensate this, pituitary is secreting more of LH and FSH. And third type of fault is pituitary is at fault and ovary is also at fault. So you will find hypo-hypo-typo. So for PCOS, what is recommended is generally, although they are considered in a new gonadotropic type of anovulation, but you find that there is some disturbance of ratio of FSH and LH, and you find that LH is relatively higher, and sometimes reversal, or this is the equality of the FSH and LH ratio. So what we do generally to make this balance, down regulation of the ovaries, just for a single cycle is enough, because she is again a young patient. And so one cycle of OCP will take down the pituitary on down regulation, and then you will start stimulation. So you will have day 2, on day 2 you will have baseline normal FSH and LH level. And novel lactose protocol will be advocated for this case, because already she has underwent for 5 days lactose protocol. Highly purified FSH can be added either starting from day 3, 5, 7, 9 or 11. There are so many protocols of additions of gonadotropins along with ovulogens, and there is literature which is saying all these are very controversial. Some say this gonadotropin should be started from day 1 itself. Some studies are saying that it should be given only on day 9 or 11 or 7, so last 3 doses only, and some are saying you should be supplementing throughout the cycle. So it will depend how the patient is responding. So first you will try with the initial 3, 5, 7 days. If she is responding very well with 3 doses, there is no need to further compare the doses of FSH and LH to her, FSH and SMD to her. So it will depend on this. Dexamethasone can be added for PCOS patient, although again this is very controversial, but for hidden androgenic abnormalities, we can add this dexamethasone, and on practical experience we are finding it's really beneficial. Metformin is again controversial. Some people are saying it is beneficial to give, some are saying not to give. But in a like balanced dose, the actual dose of this is 500 milligram TDS actually for the androgenic dose. But because this is controversial and no proven studies are saying recommending any dose. So 500 BD may be enough for practical purposes. And what we see on the day of trigger, we are finding that 4 plus 3 follicles are there. We are not planning that for IVF, but the follicle number is too much. So 4 and 3 follicles are there. What we modified here is we gave the agonist trigger here to prevent her from OHS. So agonist means decapeptide trigger is given to her, 0.2 milligram decapeptide subcutaneous, and then IVF is planned 36 to 40 hours after this decapeptide trigger. So because you cannot make the patient unsafe for this fertility treatment, so for safety of the patient, this type of trigger can be given. Now the third case is 34-year-old lady visited with the history of primary infertility 9 years, since 9 years, with infrequent menses, amenorrhea since 5 months presenting. When we see her lab investigation, AMH is very less, 0.03, AFC count on day 2 was only 2. HSG done 5 years back shows small size uterine cavity with bilateral fetal tube. Progesterone challenge, because she had 5 months of amenorrhea, we gave her this progesterone challenge test, which was negative. So we gave estrogen plus progesterone challenge test, then it was positive. Then we did the day 2 FSH and LH and B2, which we find that it is all are very less. So this is a typical case of hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. Very important here is to rule out the psychological factors like stresses, hyperprolactinemia, pituitary tumor, granuloma, Cushing syndrome, drug abuse, anabolic steroid or alcohol abuse, chronic illnesses, pituitary, radiation or surgery, Kallmann syndrome, Prader-Willi syndrome, and sometimes Sheehan syndrome as well, and other genetic deformities. And our aim is to prepare the uterus, because uterus is also small size, so better to give 2-3 cycles of estrogen therapy to her. HMG, FSH,
last one.
Last one. So this is hypohypoglycemia. We will discuss later on how to give the stimulation to them. Fourth case is again irregular intermittent cycle. Diagnostic histolactoscopy, normal finding in bilateral patient tubes. Here you see on day 2 lab investigation, FSH 39, LH 18, E2 very less, AMH very less. So this is a case of hyper-hypo. So this is a case of hyper-hypo. I think we should continue discussing this. Another case, all the estimation protocol, I will finish in half or 1 minute later on. So case number 5 is 36-year-old, 4, weight, IUI, HSA normal. She herself is willing to go to IUI. She is pregnant for 9 years, no factor, unexplained infertility. Left parameter all are normal. AMH is also good, FSH is good, LH is good, ovarian volume normal. So basic step for ovarian stimulations are, one is pre-treatment. If she is poor responder, then you have to give some testosterone treatment or androgen treatment. Then controlled ovarian stimulation. Then third thing is to trigger, and fourth is FPS. And the selection of individual will depend on her age, FSH level, BFC and AMH. So types of ovulation, maybe natural cycle or stimulation, modified, natural cycle, mild and conventional. I think these three are, upper three are not practically used. What used is conventional cycle. In conventional cycle also two types of stimulation are very common. One is ENRH, antagonist protocol, another is the long agonist protocol. In long agonist protocol, these ENRH agonists like tacapeptide and leoprolide, they have to be started on day 21 of the prior cycle. So almost 7 to 8 days before the stimulation of the ovulation, and then from the day of stimulation, because we are taking the patient for IVF and they are poor responder expectedly, so we started the high dose only, and then we have to review on day 6 again how the follicular growth is there. We continue with the half dose of the agonist further till the day of the trigger. So this is a long agonist cycle. We started agonist from day 21 of prior, and then we continue till the trigger. Antagonist cycle, we start again treatment, to be given or not to be given is controversial, but we can start stimulation from day 2 of the cycle. On day 6 we have to monitor, and then we see whether antagonists are to be given or not to be given. If it is required, 0.25 mg per day antagonist can be given. Antagonist can be given.
Lady, 2 minutes, sir.
Okay. So antagonist can be fixed dose, taxane, or single dose and multi dose. Advantage is lesser number of injections are required for antagonist, less chances of OHSS and possibility of agonist trigger. As we did in the PCOS, agonist trigger is like patient friendly trigger. Something which is may be required for dual responder is growth hormone, LH or DHEA, as in add-on therapy. This is the criteria which also help us to decide which type of protocol of stimulation we should be choosing for the patient. And this is the last phase actually. This is the 35-year-old lady diagnosed as CIN2, married since 10 years, AMH is less and other parameters are normal. So for these type of particular cases where you find there is a high chances of malignancy may be there, or they have very short time of treatment of infertility, we can go for DO stimulation protocol, also known as Shanghai protocol, where we stimulate the patient for 2 times in a single menstrual cycle. So after 1 pickup, we give a gap of, we are not waiting for again menses of intervening to come, we give a gap of 3-4 days, and then again stimulation, and then the collection.